Good afternoon, everybody. This is Brother Lloyd. Shabbat Shalom to all my Sabbath keepers out there. I hope everyone's having a blessed Sabbath day. Now, what I'm going to do is a video response to a video that I posted yesterday evening titled, Once Saved, Always Saved. A couple of the comments inspired me to just go ahead and do a video response as opposed to typing out about 100 lines worth of written response. So I decided to do a video response to help illustrate a couple of other points to really try and emphasize what the Word is teaching us, because it's all there in the Word. So with that being said, sit back with Once Saved, Always Saved, the video response. Now, a YouTuber named Miss Starmack, her YouTube name, she made a comment about the suicide portion of my video. And another young lady also made a comment in reference to suicide, stating that she had lost someone in the recent past. So in light of this, like I said, I decided to do a video response instead of just a written response, because I know many people have concerns about suicide and losing salvation. And, you know, part of the thing is, as I study and learn more and more, people, pastors and churches in general, people just are unwilling to teach what the Word says because there are too many hidden agendas. I have no agenda. My agenda is to put the truth out. I don't have a church to try and build. I don't have tithes to be collecting or any of that type of thing going on. I have no alternate agendas except to pass forth the Father's Word as I learn it, because it's important that we all understand it bare bones for the truth that it is. So, back to Ms. Starmack's comment, she stated that the only unpardonable sin is the rejection of Jesus Christ, as she stated. She also further stated that once you're saved and you commit suicide, that you cannot be removed from the Book of Life. Well, as far as being removed from the Book of Life, I think my study yesterday illustrated the fact that we can be removed from the book. But I believe, just based on her comment, she's connecting the sin of suicide to that. Now, I left a response. And basically what I said in my response to her statement was, I asked if she had any scriptures to support her belief, because I may have missed them. And I was sincere about that, because I've never seen anything related to the fact that suicide is a sin that we can repent from. And that's the key. We have to be able to repent. So the first thing I'm going to do is address one area which I believe to be a common source which leads to these types of misunderstanding in the Word, let alone that people truly don't want to teach the truth to turn off individual members coming into their churches or what have you, because they don't want to step on anyone's toes or offend them or to dash false hopes and beliefs. So they will teach you lies or dance around the truths or avoid them altogether to keep you coming back to these churches or what have you. So what I'm going to do first is read some excerpts from this article that I found online which addressed this very topic. I found that this is a common source of information that leads to this type of misunderstanding, because it caters to the belief and comfort zones that we as people can have. And it's, as far as I'm concerned, far from the truth. It just smooths over the actual truth so people feel good and believe things that may not be true. So here it is. The article is titled, If a Christian Commits Suicide, Is He Still Forgiven? Now I'm going to address the title right quick. I would prefer to say a believer, because when you start stating that you're a particular thing, people try and hold you to certain doctrines and beliefs. So I'm along the lines of a believer. You can be whatever you are, Baptist, Catholic, or what have you. But if a believer commits suicide, is he still forgiven? Now I'm going to read the excerpts verbatim and then I'm going to address it. This might seem like a perplexing question, but it does have an answer. Though the Christian who has committed suicide has committed a grave sin, he is still forgiven. But in order to understand why a Christian who commits suicide is forgiven, we first need to understand what salvation is and what it is based upon. Now, that for the first excerpt, it was very interesting to me because it right off the bat says that you are still forgiven. Now, it doesn't address the notion of your sins being pardoned. See, sins have to be pardoned. They have to be atoned for. But anyway, I'll get back to that. The next excerpt is addressed like such. It reads, is repentance necessary for salvation? This is a good question, and the answer is yes and no. Now, I'm going to stop right there. Now, when the question is asked, is repentance necessary for salvation? And the first response is yes and no. You can almost always stop right there because you're about to be fed some things that can leave you confused or just caters to what you want it to mean. But I'm going to read it. It says that this is a good question and the answer is yes and no. Now, before you throw stones, hear me out. Repentance is a necessary result of the saving work of God, not the cause of salvation. If repentance brought salvation, then salvation is by works, or rather, the ceasing of bad works. This isn't how it works. You know, in my heart, that made me chuckle because it leads to a lot of confusion. That's confusion, babble speak, or what have you. I'm going to address that right now. It says, if repentance brought salvation, then salvation is by works, or rather the ceasing of bad works. This isn't how it works. Now, that bit of rhetoric right there is total confusion, and it's a total lie. Here's the deal. Salvation is by work, His works. See, we have to be doing the work of the Heavenly Father, not our works. So I guess in part, that statement is true. It says if salvation brought works, then salvation is by works. But see, that's only if you think it's by your works. It's by the Father's works. See, we have to do the Father's work to receive salvation. We can't just go off on our own and accept and believe and repent and then go off doing our own thing. We have to do His works. There is a work for us to do as a believer in Him. We have to help bring other souls into the fold, so to speak. See, we have to be doing the Father's work. And yes, we do have to cease doing bad works. That's what repentance is about. We repent from the sinful things, the bad things that we do, and we do His works. So when the statement finishes up, this isn't how it works, that's a lie. Straight from the pit of the enemy himself. See, this type of speaking and confusion caters to what people want to believe, and it makes them comfortable that they don't have to address things that may actually be true, things that may actually be something that they don't want to deal with. People don't want to deal with the issue of suicide being a sin that you can't recover from. Now, the word doesn't say it's unpardonable, but I'm going to address that in the end so you understand that you can't come from it. So, the article continues on, back to the suicide issue. Suicide is, in effect, self-murder. The unfortunate thing about it is that the one who commits it cannot repent of it. Fact. So now, as far as I'm concerned, how's this article going to skirt around that? Pay attention. The damage is permanently done. Fact. We can see in the Bible that murderers have been redeemed. Moses, David, etc. Fact. But they had opportunities to confess their sins and repent. Yes, they did, and yes, they did. With suicide, the person does not. Another fact. But that does not mean the person is lost. Lie. Jesus bore all the person's sins, including suicide. If Jesus bore that person's sins on the cross 2,000 years ago, and if suicide was not covered, then the Christian was never saved in the first place. And the one sin of suicide is able to undo the entire work of the cross of Jesus Christ. This cannot be. Jesus either saves completely or he does not. Now, that stretch right there, based on all the other things that I kept saying fact to, creates confusion. It's Babel. Babylon. That's where it came from. Because it twists and manipulates actual truth. And it has people go, see, well, you have to be able to be saved from suicide because that's true. That makes sense. And people want that type of comfort in hearing this type of stuff. So as I read through that article, I went, wow, this is just all over the place. And a person will leave hearing and believing what they want to make themselves feel comfortable. And that's exactly what it can do. But let me show you very quickly what the word says in another sense to contradict all this Babylonian speak. 1 John 3:4 reads, whosoever committeth sin transgresseth the law. For sin is what? It's the transgression of the law. Now, are we all clear what sin is? It's the transgression of the law. His law. Now, if you look at man, if you transgress man's law, well, that's a sin of man's law, and we see that people are continually held accountable. Some unjustly, others justly. So from there we go to Mark 3. Mark 3, and we're going to read verse 28 and 29, which reads, starting with 28, verily I say unto you, all sins shall be forgiven unto the sons of men, and blasphemies wherewith soever they shall blaspheme. But verse 29 reads like this, but he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost have never forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation. Now, I'm telling you what the word says. Why even bother, though, with putting yourself in danger of eternal damnation by blaspheming the Holy Spirit? I wouldn't even want to bother with that. But let's go to Matthew 12, 31 and 32. 31 reads like this, wherefore I say unto you, every sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. This is a serious matter, people. Do not blaspheme against the Holy Spirit. Verse 32, and whosoever shall speak a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever shall speak against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world nor in the world to come. Now, that's cut and dry. It's saying you are done if you blaspheme against the Holy Spirit. Understand, people, the Holy Spirit, or the set apart Spirit, is the ultimate teacher. Shows us all things, teaches us all things, causes all things to be brought to remembrance. This is a serious matter. If you blaspheme the Holy Spirit, it's a wrap. So to Ms. Starmack, yes, she's on the money, as most people are when it comes to blaspheming the Holy Spirit. And as far as that being the unpardonable sin or unforgivable sin, that's a fact. The word says it. So where does this leave any one of us when it comes to suicide? Well, let's go here. Now that we understand that part of it. Now, remember early on in the article I was reading, it says that our Savior Yahshua died on the cross and paid the price for all our sins, every single one, suicide included. Well, you got me there, I agree. But I'm not going to confuse you by adding Babylonian speech after this, after I said I agree. Here's the deal. Here is the caveat, so to speak. He paid the price for all our sins, yet many don't care or accept it, as we see by the fact that so many people are still evil, doing evil things, and die in sin constantly. Many people choose to decide with the enemy and live their lives accordingly. Now, we already know that everyone is not going to heaven, yet the sins have been paid for. But what happened? They, for the most part, people in sin and dying in sin, they have rejected Yahshua. They have rejected Christ and his promises to us. Now, I'm going to repeat that. All of our sins have been paid for. Yes, every single one. But we still have a choice. If we choose to reject what he has done, i.e. reject him, if we choose to reject him and what he's done, we are still capable of dying in sin. Remember, everyone, we have a choice. When our sins are presented before us, though, we must acknowledge them, and we must do what? Repent. Understand, everybody, our Savior has to be able to make an atonement for our sins so that they fall on the enemy in the end. If we don't repent of those sins, they stay on us, and ultimately they all fall on the enemy. But if we don't repent and release them, so to speak, so that we can be pardoned of them, so that they may be blotted out, they stay on us and the enemy, of course, because he's perpetrated all sin. See, the word says in Revelation 22:11, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still, and he which is filthy, let him be filthy still, and he that is righteous, let him be righteous still, and he that is holy, let him be holy still. But understand, everybody, this is the final decree of the state of our being. If we commit suicide, the sin is still on us even unto our death, and it stays there. Now, I certainly agree that to blaspheme against the Holy Spirit is the unpardonable sin. The word says so. And I also understand that it doesn't say that suicide is an unpardonable sin. But if you commit it, how can you repent of it? See, there are sins that we commit that are never going to be repented of, and they're going to be on us. Suicide is one of them. See, the catch or the twist to suicide is, it's a sin you commit against yourself, so you leave yourself no way to repent of it. The Father doesn't have to say that sin is an unpardonable sin. At the thought, we must be able to conquer this sin as well as any other sin through the power that's endowed upon us through our Almighty Savior. If we lack, due to our choices, if we lack the ability, if we lack the power because we haven't devoted ourselves to the armor that should be on us, we are susceptible to anything. If we lack that strength to rebuke sin at the first thought of it, we may not only commit suicide, we may even rob, steal, destroy, as the enemy does, or even murder, as the enemy would have us all do to each other and ourselves. But of all those other sins, there's an opportunity for repentance. So because suicide is one of those sins that we may not want to address or deal with in its reality and its finality as to what it does to the soul that does it, it speaks for itself. The Father doesn't have to say, oh, well, that's unpardonable too, because they can't repent of it if they do it. But it's a sad but true reality of one of the many sins that we commit against mankind and ourselves. And with that being said, hold true to the Father and His Word. Develop that relationship to strengthen yourself, to avoid that sin and any other, so that you have the ability to repent and turn away. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.